it's great to, what a privilege it is to share from God's Word, His precious Word. Tonight here we're going to look at the first book of the Bible, the book of Genesis, chapter 7. We'll not read the whole chapter, but we'll read the majority of it just for time's sake. So chapter 7 of the book of Genesis, and we're going to commence in verse 1. And the Lord said unto Noah, Come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Of every clean beast thou shalt take to thee by sevens, the male and his female, and of beasts that are not clean by two, the male and his female. Verse 4, For yet 7 days, and I will cause it to rain upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights, and every living substance that I have made will I destroy from off the face of the earth. And Noah did according unto all that the Lord commanded him. And Noah was 600 years old when the flood of waters was upon the earth. And Noah went in, that's into the ark, and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives with him. There was 8 in total into the ark because of the waters of the flood. Verse 10, And it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the 2nd month, the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were open. And the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights, verse 15. And they went in unto Noah into the ark, 2 by 2, of all flesh, wherein is the breath of life. Verse 17. And the flood was 40 days upon the earth, and the waters increased and bare up the ark, and it was lift up above the earth. And the waters prevailed and were increased greatly upon the earth, and the ark went upon the face of the waters. And the waters prevail exceedingly upon the earth, and all the high hills that were under the whole heaven were covered. 15 cubits upward did the water prevail, and the mountains were covered. And all flesh died that moved upon the earth, both of fowl, and of cattle, and of beast, and of every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth, and every man. All in whose nostrils was the breath of life, of all that was in the dry land died. And every living substance was destroyed which was upon the face of the ground, both man and cattle, and the creeping things, and the fowl of heaven, and they were destroyed from the earth. And Noah only remained alive, and they that were with him in the ark. We know the Lord will bless his word to us this evening. The title I want to put forward in relation to this sermon this evening is Noah's Lockdown. Noah's Lockdown. Over the last 2 years or so, we've been acquainted and well aware of this coronavirus, which has been a dominant theme in the media right across the world. Many people from all classes and spheres of society have been in lockdown. Well, some people may think it's been unfair, and maybe frustration has kicked in, and patience, maybe at the peak for 50 days or so being in lockdown. But this evening I want to show you a person called Noah and his family, 8 in total, being in lockdown for 1 year, 17 days in total. 1 year, 17 days in total in an ark because of the devastation of God's judgment upon an ungodly world full of wickedness and sin, in which this flood came, which was universal. Many people think Noah was in the ark for 150 days, as in chapter 7, verse 24, it says, And the waters prevailed upon the earth 150 days. But this was not the case, because Noah and his family arrived on the ark 7 days before the catastrophic torrential rain was activated under God's judgment, which occurred on the 17th of the 2nd month, verse 10 and 11 of our passage here in Genesis 7. It says, And it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month. So when did Noah, the question has to be asked this evening, so when did Noah debark, leave, being in lockdown from this ark? Well, in Genesis 8, from verse 14 to 16, it says, and in the second month, on the 27th day of the month, was the earth dried. And Noah spoke on, and God spoke unto Noah, saying, go forth of the ark, thou and thy wife and thy sons' wives with thee. So Noah and his family were in lockdown for approximately 1 year, 17 days in total. Noah did not have, of course, the entertainment tools, the entertainment systems that we have in this generation, such as the internet. Of course, the internet's a great tool if it's used right, but sadly it has been completely abused and lives are being completely destroyed through it. But saying that, in Noah's generation, as the universal flood came, as Noah was around 600 years old, in verse 6, there was an advancement in social dynamics, scientific development, as their building programs and cities started to expand. In Noah's generation, people began to multiply, and the world became increasingly urban, as many cities started to spring up and increase and develop. It was like an industrial revolution, which had transformed, in a sense, the way people lived. They became more sophisticated, permissive, and worldly. Human rights, I can do anything according to my, what I want. There was no boundaries, there was no parameters. And human rights had become more prominent than traditional values. They loved their self-indulgent pleasures more than God. There's nothing wrong with pleasures. God has created pleasures for us, but the problem arises when we abuse them and self-indulgence takes place. Sin was prevailing. Iniquity was increasing more and more. It was widespread. It was universal. There was immorality to such a high degree. Idolatry, lawlessness, vice, violence, sin abounding everywhere, such decadence, no parameters, no restraints. People, you see, were fascinated with the occult, and as a result, human degeneration accelerated to such high-handed sin as the deep things of Satan controlled many. In Genesis 6, verse 5, it says, and God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. You see, the Bible puts man in the dust, folks. It shows you how fallen man is. This is why we need a Savior. Genesis 6, verse 11, the earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence, for all flesh had corrupted his way upon the earth. We can certainly see the parallelism in our generation, how it's going like that. But in the midst of all this evil, sin, and corruption, Noah found grace in the sight of the Lord, and walked and lived for God, being a preacher of righteousness. Noah was saved. His sins were forgiven. He had peace with the living God. He was in fellowship with the living God. He wanted to glorify the Lord. He wanted to serve the Lord. He experienced God's grace. In Genesis 6, verse 8, it says, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. I wonder today, or this evening, folks, have you experienced God's saving grace? There's common grace to everyone on this planet. God in his goodness gives us the sunshine. He gives us the rain. He gives us material things. That's common grace. He gives us food and water and clothing and transport and homes and so forth and families. But have you experienced the most important grace? Saving grace. You see, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. It's by grace that you're saved through faith, not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Grace, of course, is God's loving kindness towards us. It is God's unmerited favor. No one deserves it. In fact, everyone deserves God's wrath because we have broken and violated his law high-handed, which means we are guilty before our Maker, our Creator, who is holy, who is righteous, a God who loveth righteousness, but hateth iniquity. John Phillips says, grace involves receiving something we do not deserve. God's grace reaches out to the lost and ruined people and offers them his love, kindness, and forgiveness instead of his wrath and judgment. Have you experienced saving grace this evening? Do you know your sins forgiven? God, you see, is long-suffering. He's a God of forbearance, a God of restraint. He doesn't give us what we deserve. And he always gives mercy before judgment, as we're going to look at this account this evening in greater detail. As he warned the people in Noah's generation that the flood was coming if they did not turn from their wicked ways, their sin, and repent. This flood would be the greatest flood ever to take place on planet Earth, then and forever, as God has promised to send. He will never send a universal flood again, as he has given us his covenant. As you see the rainbow in the sky, that is God's covenant. You see, God is a covenant-keeping God, and what God decrees will always come to pass. Many scientists today do not want to admit that Noah's flood took place, which caused the fossil and geological formations that prevailed upon the earth. You see, if they believed in Noah's flood, which was a judgment upon sin, man's wickedness, then they would put themselves in the arena that they are accountable to God because of their sin. But Noah's flood, which was universal, took place despite their evil heart of unbelief. Even the blessed, glorious, all-conquering, all-sufficient Lord Jesus Christ clarifies this and verifies this regarding the flood. In the Gospel of Luke, the Lord himself says, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it also in the days of the Son of Man. So Jesus has confirmed, clarified that Noah's flood took place. He says, referring obviously to his second coming, they did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. This evening, folks, very quickly, I want to break this passage, Genesis 7, up into four sections. First of all, we have the coming of the flood in verse 10 and 11. The coming of the flood, verse 10. And it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth. The people in Noah's time were without an excuse. It was high-handed sin against God, their creator, their maker. They had been warned for many years through Noah, who was a preacher of righteousness, and also by an object lesson by building the ark and right in front of them. They heard Noah's warning that the flood was coming because of sin, because of man's wickedness, and the people needed to repent and turn to God. They needed to seek God's grace and mercy. And also they seen the building of the ark, which was an object lesson. They heard the word of God through Noah, but also they seen the building of the ark. The preaching and the building of the ark were two significant warnings, signs given by God to mankind that judgment was coming as the earth was corrupt and filled with violence. But what? How did they respond? They mocked. They took it lightly. If you're doing outreach today, I was involved in an open air yesterday, and well, thank the Lord, most people received the gospel literature and Gospels of John and so forth, but you'll always get folk who'll take it lightly. And just in Noah's generation, like our generation, the majority, they take it lightly, the things of God. They laugh about Christ is returning. Christ, folks, is returning not as a savior in his humiliation. He's returning in blazing glory with his holy angels and flaming fire as a judge to destroy, to punish the inhabitants of this world because of their wickedness. Are you prepared? Are you ready? And they mocked, they took it lightly, they laughed at judgment as it had not yet materialized, as Noah was building the ark. Noah was the laughing target on his generation. They would have called him a fool. They would have called him an idiot. They would have called this man as mad. He's insane. He's lost his mind. It would have been the main joke amongst families, friends, work colleagues, schools, university, businesses, etc., etc. They thought they were invincible, you see, with their wicked, sinful lifestyles. Since they did not suffer at that particular present time the fatal consequences of their sin, thinking they would get away with it. Solomon, in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 8, he says, because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil. People think, you see, in their folly, because sin is a great deceiver, the heart is a great deceiver, and they think in their folly, being deceived in their depraved minds and hearts, that they can sin and get away with it. Because judgment hasn't entered in their name. But the Bible makes it abundantly clear, be sure your sin will find you out. I wonder this evening, are you still in your sin? You see, if you're still holding on to your sin, you're under God's wrath. Or has your sins been wonderfully cast away, purged, cleansed, that you're in Christ? Christ is in you, the hope of glory. That you're saved from your sin, the power of it. You're saved from the penalty and the guilt of it. And you're saved from the wrath to come. Noah was commanded by God and obeyed to place himself in the ark 7 days preceding the commencement of the flood as God shut the door. In verse 10, and it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth. God shut the door, verse 16b, and the Lord shut him in. God shut the door. Noah was in a place of security. Noah was in a place of safety. Noah was in a place of rest, peace. Noah was in a place of protection. But the long suffering of God, the forbearance, the restraint of God had run its course now. There was no more grace. There was no more mercy outside the ark. God shut Noah in and his family. There was no more laughing. There was no more taking life as if life is a great big joke. There was no more taking the things of God lightly and laughing and mocking and slandering it. There was no more parties. There was no more pleasures. There was no more entertainments. There was no more mocking. There was no hope. There was no more joy. There was no more ease. There was no more peace. Because, folks, it was the day of the Lord. It was the year, the time of their vindication. God's perfect wrath and justice was activated in verse 10. And it came to pass after 7 days that the waters of the flood were upon the earth. God shut Noah in and his family. I wonder this evening, have you had assurance that you're in God's ark, Jesus Christ? Jesus says, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he or she shall be saved. You see, God shut the door, place of safety. Have you entered through the door? Are you in Jesus Christ? Secondly, here, as we move on very quickly, we find here the cause of the flood in verse 11b, the cause of the flood. The same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were open, and the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. The cause of the flood. There's three main sources of the flood waters that are presented to us from these two verses. Three main sources. First of all, in verse 12, we have the rain of the flood waters. It says in verse 12, and the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. In verse 11, it tells us the release of the flood waters. The windows of heaven were open. In verse 11 also, it talks about the reservoir of the flood waters. The same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up. Verse 12, the rain of the flood waters. And the rain was upon the earth 40 days and 40 nights. This rain was very heavy. It was violent. It was torrential. It was a great downpour. Preceding the flood, the people had never experienced before, as the ground had been watered by a mist. This must have been a great shock, upheaval to Noah's generation, as the flood was introduced by this violent, torrential, heavy rain. They would have thought to themselves, what is happening? What is going on? This was consistent, continuous rain, as it never stopped, just shy of 6 weeks, as it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. God must have performed a miracle here, which is nothing to him. As with God, all things are possible. He's the omnipotent one, all-powerful God, as all things are possible with him, because clouds in themselves cannot contain that much water. I'm sure over the last number of years, through the news, and especially in England, and when you hear of the floods in England, and it's only a number of hours of heavy downpours, and the catastrophe, how it spreads, how much more 40 days and 40 nights. The rain of the flood waters, verse 12. Then we have in verse 11, the release of the waters, the windows of heaven were open. The windows of heaven were open. These waters did not have the same source as the rain from the clouds, but actually came from above the clouds, more than likely, in which God released the waters which were above the firmament from the skies God created on the second day. Then we have the reservoir of the flood waters in verse 11. The same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up. These were subterranean reservoirs of water below the earth's surface, great underground reservoirs of water. This word broken is split, burst up, open, burst forth. It would have been like a great volcanic type of eruptions of water breaking forth. So the floodwaters came above the earth's surface as well as below the earth's surface, such devastation. So we've looked at the coming and the cause of the flood very quickly as we move on. Thirdly, we have the character of the flood. Verse 18, the character of the flood, and the waters prevailed and were increased greatly upon the earth, and the ark went upon the face of the waters, and the waters prevailed exceedingly upon the earth, and all the high hills that were under the whole heaven were covered. 15 cubits upward did the waters prevail, and the mountains were covered. The character of the flood. The dimensions tell us that the waters of the flood surpassed the highest mountains by 15 cubits, which is approximately 22 feet above the highest mountains. Verse 20, 15 cubits upward did the waters prevail and the mountains were covered. Which mountains did the ark cover? Well, in Genesis chapter 8, it explains, and the ark rested in the seventh month, on the 17th day of the month, upon the mountains of Ararat. Now, Mount Ararat is almost 17,000 feet high and is located, of course, in the eastern part of Turkey. So the flood waters were at least 3 miles high above the earth's surface. This flood had to be universal, because such a volume of water in a designated area would have wrought the complete destruction of the earth by its tremendous weight. The earth, with its diameter over 24,000 miles, would have been under much pressure with the universal flood. But if it was spread universal, it would have been no problem whatsoever. If it was in a designated area, it certainly would have been under much pressure. But because it was universal, it was no problem at all to accommodate. Someone said such a flood would mean no more to the earth than a profuse sweat on the human body. Well, the critics will say, what about the Himalayas mountains, like Everest, like K2, being 11 or 12,000 feet higher than Mount Ararat, which are approximately 29,000 feet tall? The answer to that is that these mountains may not have been created by the, would have been created probably by the flood after, as the earth was completely renovated due to the aftermath of the flood. You see, in Noah's day, before the flood, the earth was completely different. It was more level. But after Noah's flood, the earth completely changed. It had a totally geological different format. Many scholars believe the world was more level then, before the flood came, and then the geological formation structure changed after the force of the flood, which formed the enormous mountains like the Himalayas, such as Everest and K2. When the Lord Jesus returns in the second coming, the earth is going to be renovated. The geological formation structure will change, because it tells us in Revelation 16, and every island fled away and the mountains were not found. When Christ returns, I believe the earth's going to be flattened again, renovated. And Jerusalem's going to be elevated. But also in the end of the millennial kingdom, I believe Christ is returning. He's coming back to claim his inheritance, which is rightly for his. Psalm 2, he's coming back to cast the false prophet and the Antichrist alive into the lake of fire. He's coming to cast Satan into the bottomless pit. He's coming back to restore Israel. He's coming back to set up his kingdom, which the Jews are waiting on. Yes, the kingdom of God is in the people of God, the church today. That's the spiritual, but there's a literal kingdom, I believe. And Christ is returning, second coming, to judge the inhabitants of this earth because of their evil. He's going to set up his kingdom of peace, righteousness, worship, 1,000-year reign. And after the millennial kingdom, God will then destroy this world with fire and usher in a new heaven and a new earth for his people, his bride, his redeemed people. Where in this generation, the people are obsessed with climate change. Of course, there's nothing wrong with trying to look after the earth, but they're obsessed with it. If they only would read their Bibles, God is going to destroy this world, because this world is a fallen world. Even in Romans 8, the world cries out for its redemption. The character of the flood produced 7 days countdown, 40 days and nights of heavy, extreme torrential rain, 150 days as the earth was submerged by the water, 40 days waiting as the ark came to rest at Mount Ararat, and also 7-day intervals until Noah knew it was safe to leave the ark onto the dry land when God instructed him. Noah and his family with the animals were in lockdown for 1 year, 17 days approximately. What a test. God, folks, will certainly test us. God will test our patience. God will also test our faith. Noah, 1 year, 17 days in lockdown. So we've looked at the coming, the cause, and the character of the flood. But finally, as we conclude here, we have the carnage from the flood. Verse 21 to 23. The carnage from the flood. Verse 21. And all flesh died that moved upon the earth, both of fowl, of cattle, beast, and every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. And every man, all in whose nostrils was the breath of life of all that was in the dry land, died. Everything perished. There was no more mocking, no more laughing, no more parties, no more pleasures. It was the day of the Lord, God's judgment. Everything perished under God's perfect justice and wrath, apart from Noah, his family, the animals in the ark, and some sea creatures. Such devastation. God will not be mocked. It is a very fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Who has warned you to flee from the wrath to come? It is coming. The word of God is filled with warnings referring to the return of Christ. There is no escape. Every eye will see him. You see, sin will always be punished. God never turns a blind eye to sin. Sin, you see, is repulsive in God's sight. Sin destroys everything. Sin destroys the individual. Sin destroys families. Sin destroys societies. Sin destroys townlands, villages, towns, cities, nations. Sin fills our hospitals. Sin fills our cemeteries. Sin fills our prisons. Sin destroys. And ultimately, folks, sin is a high-handed violation against God. Sin will always be punished. And if you hold on to your sin and your pride, you will face God's wrath. And there's only two places. It's glory land, heaven, sins forgiven, saved by God's grace, being in Jesus Christ. Or folks, if you hold on to your sin, it's that lake of fire under God's judgment. I don't get any pleasure saying that, but that's the reality. We have to be faithful to God's word. It's judgment, it's hell, it's punishment. But the great news is there's provision. There was provision in Noah's day, but they laughed, they mocked, they scorned, they took it lightly. Noah was a laughing stock. But at the end of it, he wasn't the fool. Because the Bible tells us that the fool, the person who is a real fool, is the ones who do not believe in God. The fool saith there is no God. Have you got your sins forgiven? Have you peace with God? Has your sins been cleansed, purged? Is Christ in you? Are you in a living, dynamic, supernatural relationship with a living God? Have you got your sins removed? You see, no sin can enter heaven. The Lord Jesus Christ, when he was on this earth, when he performed miracle after miracle, the Bible only records 36, but I dare say maybe hundreds or thousands, we do not know, because many times it says they brought all the sick to him and he healed them all. Christ, there was never a display of divine power ever in history, and especially amongst his people, the Jews. The miracles he did, he raised the dead. He touched the blind, he healed the lame, he had power over sin, he had power over the devil, he had power over demons, he had power over disease, he had power over nature. No man spoke like this man. He was a promised Messiah, and yet the Pharisees especially, and the children of Israel, he came unto his own, but his own received him not. Such a evil heart of unbelief. The evidence was there. The evidence was there in Noah's day. He was a preacher of righteousness. He was building an ark, which took many, many years to build. The object lesson was there. The word of God went forth. They were without an excuse. And in Jesus' day especially, they were without an excuse. In our generation, they're without an excuse. The word of God goes forth, and yet the majority turn their back on it. We will not have this man to rule over us. Some people during the lockdown, over those 2 years or so, they think that the coronavirus was a long period. When people were locked down for the 50 days or whatever it was. But Noah was 1 year, 17 days, approximately, as he waited upon God and obeyed God. Noah did not go before the Lord. Be wise, folks. If you're not saved, think of eternity. It's a forever lockdown in outer darkness, where the devil is and his demonic powers of darkness, demons. It's a place, the lake of fire, Gehenna, where there's no hope, no mercy, no grace, no love, no exits. Pain, torments, fear, where the fire is unquenchable. The provision is there. You're without an excuse. Don't blame God if you perish. Blame yourself. People end up in hell because they're Christ rejectors. God has given us the ark, Jesus Christ. God had given that generation the ark through Noah. But praise God tonight, folks. There's a way of escape. and is found in the glorious, wonderful Lord Jesus Christ, who is the door. He says, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. Have you come God's way through Jesus Christ? A religion will not save you. A minister will not save you. A priest will not save you. It's only one way. It's an exclusive way. It's God's way. It's Jesus Christ who is the way, the truth, and the life. Have you entered in through the door? You see, Noah was the only one, and his family entered in. And as a result, God shut them in. The day of grace was finished. Do not play about or trifle about with God's grace. No one knows even the day of our death. And the Bible makes it clear, it's appointed unto man once to die, and after this the judgment. Are you prepared? Are you ready? Are you saved? Have you entered in? Or will it be too late? Just like in Noah's day, as God shut the door. This evening we've looked at Noah's lockdown. 1 year, 17 days. But it's nothing compared to eternity. I trust, be wise. Today, if you'll hear his voice, harden not your heart. May the Lord bless these few words to us this evening. Thank you for your time.